same kind of different as me, a story based on my late wife, Debbie, and her friendship and my friendship with Denver Moore, a homeless man that she had a dream about, who was poor but wise and would change our city and our lives. And it all came to true. Unfortunately, Debbie passed away before she saw her dream become a reality, but her dream did become a reality through our book. Our city was changed, our lives were changed, and now we're making a movie.
I'm a preacher's kid from the South who is committed to not making cheesy Christian films. I got a call from somebody saying, hey, there's this book I want you to read. And they said it was a big faith-based book. And I said, not interested, you know. Not that I don't love God, because I do. I just don't want to make, you know, some saccharine cheesy film. I want to tell real stories and meaningful stories.
A lawyer friend of mine said that he had a friend named Michael Carney who was a screenwriter and had worked with a lot of studios in helping them perfect scripts that were given to the studios that weren't quite right to get on the screen. And he was usually had a really quick fix for something. So he said, would you be interested in meeting Michael Carney? And he has got a writing partner named Alex Ford. And I said, no, I'm not interested in that. And interestingly enough, the same lawyer was asking Michael Carney, do you want to meet Ron Hall and help him with this script? And he said, no, I don't want to meet him. I'm not interested in this story.
And then after they sent me 3 FedEx copies of the book and saying, please, as a friend, just read the book, I said, okay, I will.
I wrote the screenplay about 7 or 8 times. One day, I don't know why, I just flat couldn't write another word. And I just gave up, and I said, okay, I'll meet him. And about the same time, he had called his father.
And I'm like, Pops, you know, I want you to pray because I don't want to miss out on what God has for me. But they sent me this book, and he said, what's the name of the book? And I said, same kind of different as me. And he was like, I bought 400 copies of that book and passed them out. And literally, I was like, oh, no. Like, this, I'm totally pegged on this, right?
With that, it felt like that was a sign that we needed to meet.
My wife originally read it and gave it to me and suggested that I read it. When I finally did, I ended up having a conversation with one of my employees about the book, and he got on an airplane and was flying somewhere going from east to west and happened to be sitting next to Darren Moorman, one of the other producers of the movie. And as a result of that conversation, he introduced me to Darren, and that was about 2 years ago.
And I got my hands on it. And as a producer, you're always looking for, you know, what's a great story, and, you know, and this one just spoke to me. It moved me. I wept, and I laughed, and I just said, I have to do this film. It wasn't until a good friend of mine, Kale Boyder, who's a producer on the project, his boss, Mary Parent, I didn't know she was going to read it, read it.
I read the book first. I couldn't put it down. I read it from start to finish in just a few hours, and I was blown away by the story, by the characters, and then I read the script, and I got to about page 65, and I broke down crying, and I thought, I have to be involved in this project.
I said it's a story about 3 people. It's not a story about you and this homeless guy. Without Debbie, Ron's wife, there would not be a story. And most people were really immediately going to, this is a buddy film with these 2 dudes, you know, the international art dealer and the homeless guy and how they get together. And, you know, and my take was those guys would have never been together without this incredible woman, you know, that was his wife. And she was the anchor of the film.
That was kind of our our take on it, and it resonated with Ron. And right off the bat, it was nice to hear when we asked him at one point when he knew he was going to go with us. He said 5 minutes. It took about 5 minutes, and from then on, he's become an incredible friend. I consider him a lifelong friend, and it was a really magical experience to go through the whole thing with him.
The fact that Ron was the only one still alive that could tell the story, that actually experienced the story, made a lot of sense to this dumb country boy that, like, I better sit with him and spend a lot of time with that guy and have him talk this thing back to me. And so that's what we did, and he's such a deep well. And
my greatest desire in telling this story was to honor Debbie and to honor Denver. And it had not been done. So he said, I will protect that. We will honor them and we will tell the truth. And he said, if I get it right, he said, I want to be your director. I said, exactly. I make that promise right now. And so that's how we came here as a team. Michael is the director. Alex Ford is a co-writer with us. And I think it was certainly God ordained that we be together as a team, and we brought this together as a team.
Denver used to say, coincidences are God's way of remaining anonymous. And there are so many coincidences that have been associated with us getting to this point in this movie that it was clear that that God wanted this movie to be made.
When it's real people's lives, real people's stories, there's an obligation and a pressure that's just that much greater. This is the legacy of their lives. And Ron has been a very integral part, not to mention it's a story. He wrote the book and then co-wrote the screenplay, and he's been with us here every day. And there's times where all of a sudden you'll look over he's crying.
If you're going to tell someone's life story that's had so much impact on people, and him and Denver raised $85 million for the homelessness cause afterwards. So it was pretty much no brainer.
Rolling. Clear, set, and back run, and action.
Let me ask you, when you give a homeless man a plate of food or a dollar, what do you think you're doing?
Helping.
Nah, a plate of food don't change nothing. They'll still be homeless. All you're doing is saying you're an invisible. I see you. Thank you.
I mean, when you look at the cast across the board, they're some of the best actors that, of our time. Two Oscar winners. I mean, Jaimin's multiple nominations. It's incredible.
We were blessed to be, have four Academy Award nominated actors, two Academy Award winners. So the thing that, as the director of me, that's a very rare opportunity on your first feature film to be, playing with that team, right? So it was basically for me to get out of their way. We would do the research and we would talk about this, and this was the intent, and then would let them do their thing,
Action.
Get your plate.
Yeah, I actually need two.
Amazing how far a little tender love and care can go.
The book is not an easy or obvious translation to a film, and I thought Michael did a very nice job, along with Ron, of finding a way into that story to make it accessible to an audience, to tell a journey for all three characters, Denver, Debbie, Ron, and of course the transformation of the work they were all doing and at this mission. So I just thought it captured a lot of different things and went into some really nice specifics about what they all were dealing with at this time. I mean, it was, you feel like the story, it's amazing the way these three people all interacted with each other, and the story finds them right at the apex of the most significant time of maybe their lives.
Kinnear was always my first choice, and he actually looked like Ron, You know, he didn't talk like him, but he could. You know, he just has this incredible ability to disappear in a role to where you're not watching Kinnear. You know, you're watching Ron Hall, and that's what we wanted. And he was the right age, and he had the nice hair, and he, you know, it was all the things that we needed if we're telling a true story, which we are. So he was at the top of the list from the get-go.
Ready? Go ahead, Greg. Hi, I'm Greg Kinnear, making a movie right here in Mississippi, and I just got one question for you. Are you ready?
Yes!
I had to rush it because, hold on.
Sorry, sir.
Gosh, he really scared me. Threw me. I thought I was being attacked.
Kinnear, my buddy, he's so wonderful. I couldn't wait to come back and share a set with him.
Boy, do I know how to set up a trend.
Kinnear's timing is exceptional, and it can be deadly at the wrong moment. I've experienced that. It's so hard to keep a straight face and focus. If he just hits one in the right way, oh, Lord. He's perfect to play this gentleman. Perfect.
Renee is Renee. It's impossible not to be drawn to her. I was so excited when she said yes to this part because Debbie is she's the center of the movie. She's the light of the movie. She's the catalyst of the film. And she, you know, like Ron's character, goes through a tremendous amount.
She really became Debbie, you know. You know, when I was talking to her at first and we were talking to her about the role, you could just see her heart for this space, you know. And she's one that will never tell you what she's doing, but she's doing a lot behind the scenes to help people. And she's just a very kind and generous human being. But her being from Katy, Texas, and her, you know, really diving in and completely capturing the spirit of who Debbie is, I can't see anyone else in that role. And it was an incredible blessing to have her come in and again feel the support of her throughout the process. And you know, you know why she's one of America's sweethearts when you see this film.
My name's Debbie. What's yours?
Killer.
Oh, nice to meet you, Killer. One of the things that I love about this story is that there are so many themes of healing. There's spiritual healing, there's literal healing, and with Debbie and Ron, it's about a long-time relationship that is severely damaged and worthwhile and worth enough to make the effort to repair it. And by sharing this mission to help other people, they come together again. And I'm a hopeless romantic sucker at heart, and I found that to be beautiful.
Interestingly, the relationship between my character Denver and Debbie was almost very, on the surface, it was quite limited, their contact. But the spiritual awareness was bigger than, you know, the interaction together for the time they've known each other, I think. That's certainly what I took from it. You know, they had such a strong connection spiritually, but very little physical interaction during the time they knew each other. I think Ron was the mediator, basically, and sort of the connected soul between those two.
Done some bad things, Miss Debbie. Never told you. Hope I might not have to.
Jaima was the first one on board, and again, he was our first choice, which was crazy that we got a couple first choices. The thing about Jaima is, and I started doing research, and I ran across this little article. It's like he was homeless, and I was like, what? You know, when you know, then I start to read more, right, about, you know, he'll have to understand. You know, you start thinking like, I've got to meet this guy, you know.
Talk about incredible stories. of just his life. Chaiman is passionate about playing this guy. I mean, he knew that this role was for him, and so, you know, I got a front row seat to watch, you know, something I think really transformative happen. You know, the relationship between us has to be, it's a lot of different colors and a lot of different layers. It starts obviously not in a very good place. And there's suspicion, there's distrust, and there's honesty, and ultimately there's love and belief in one another. And to go through that whole arc is really great, and to do it with him is excellent.
You're not a bad man. You have the strongest heart.
What's not appealing about a story like that, that's so profound and so, you know, has a, which resonance speaks to every one of us, you know? And wherever you go in the world, you'll have homelessness. I found myself on the streets briefly. And I think it's time for most of us to have a fair view of homelessness. And certainly some people end up on the street, and how, you know, one thing leads to another, and it's just like a roller coaster, and it's a dream killer.
In a way, Earl is very close to being homeless. Earl, the character I play, having PTSD or having this disturbance that keeps him drinking. If he didn't have the family around him, he'd be in the streets. There's no doubt about it. So he's closer to Denver than he is to his own family. And he doesn't acknowledge that. You know, sometimes people who are alike don't get along.
How come you never drink? You never drink with me? Never? You're too proud to drink with your old man?
Well, looks like you're doing okay on your own.
Oh, here we go, huh? Here we go again.
One thing I'll always remember is watching John Voight work. He, first of all, I think it's very important to understand that he doesn't just show up and just say some lines. This guy, he's in it, and he's wanting to understand the character. He's wanting to understand everything about why he was that way. Because he played a guy that wasn't exactly a good guy. Earl was a... had a lot of issues himself, and he wasn't the best father. He was an alcoholic. He was a bit racist. And John didn't shy away from any of that.
If Miss Debbie needs some help in the kitchen.
You weren't really gonna let him have that gun, were you?
Oh, come on, Earl. Are we gonna do this right now?
Oh. I'm gonna go out and make myself a drink.
What is it about Denver that bothers you?
Why should anything bother me about him? I think giving a loaded shotgun to a man who lives in a dumpster on purpose is a perfectly sane thing to do. Just don't do it when I'm around.
I fell in love with Earl all over again watching John play him. He has done the most beautiful job, not only just to honor my father, who was just a real crusty old character, but he's made him alive. He's made him a likable, you know, person, not just an old racist drunk. Now he's made him a guy that's fun. That element of my father was always there. I couldn't see it because of the anger that I carried for him all these years. But to see Earl now, I miss him so much, I can't stand it.
Hey, Mommy, you want to say grace?
Of course.
Why didn't you let Denford do it?
He was a real character, you know. Everybody talks about, holy God, stay away from Earl, you know. But we found, I found things in it. My instinct took me in certain directions, and I passed it by him. I said, well, you know, I think he's got to be funny. I mean, he can't be. I don't know how to play a character. I honestly don't know how to play a character, you know, straight ahead without a sense of humor, without having some sense of humor about how do you portray him. And the idiocy of Earl seemed perfect, you know.
Does he have to be invited to every family gathering?
So we had some fun with it, you know, and I think we did the right thing with it, you know. I think when I say we, it's because you're collaborating. Michael, our director, is such a nice young man, and very talented, and he's researched it deeply. And Greg has his own style, and the combination of the personalities, that makes something altogether different than you can write on a page. You say, well, that's the way you're responding to each other. That's your chemistry together. So you go that way and something is created.
He brought so much to the role. You know, the character was a kind of a prickly character, right? And John understood, and we talked a lot about, we got to make sure that this guy is just not a one-note character because you will not like him.
I thought, well, you got beginning, middle, and end. You got just enough to make the character work, and maybe I can help out.
John always gave it this thing behind the eyes. You knew there's something else there. And when you don't have, because he, you know, he was one of the supporting characters, so he wasn't there the whole time. You have just a few scenes to create this story arc in, and we couldn't have been more blessed to have that guy, you know, taking the stand for us. So John was amazing.
For a film like this, I mean, you can only have good people on it. You see what I mean? It can only attract good people because nobody's here for the money. We're here because all of us, every one of us, are somewhat moved by the story one way or the other, one fashion or another.
Michael's doing a great job. He's had a great vision for this from day one. From the moment he started writing this, he's just had a great vision. And I think he's just had a great time connecting with the talent and the crew.
I mean, most of the morning is going around to everyone in the city of Jackson who he comes up with, and he knows everybody, and wants everyone to, you know, feel good, have a good day. He's there with them. He's just a very positive spirit in the movie.
The first things that were said to me about Michael came from Greg, and Renee said, he's good, John. And when people, we all are professionals, and when someone of our peer group says something like that, we know exactly what it means. It means, you know, we're in good hands, the man has talent, you'll have some fun. It's gonna be good.
He is prepared. He had a vision for this film. He has great instincts, and he nurtures a performance. You know, he makes it safe for you to try things. And that's a very special quality, because you have to feel safe to stick your neck out. And he makes it a pleasure to try. So, and he's fun. He laughs a lot. He knows everybody's name on the crew. And they love working with him, too.
Everybody that's involved in the film, you know, has obviously read the script, but it touched them in a way where people felt like they just wanted to be a part of it.
Not because we were paying them more than they could be making. Many people sacrificed taking films that would have paid them a lot more just to be a part of telling this great story.
Got it, thank you. Well done, everybody.
Oh, it's done?
Yeah. Is that off or crooked?
Better.
You know, I spent most of my life as an art dealer, and I became wealthy as an art dealer. But my friendship with Denver made me rich. And that no matter what I do the rest of my life is going to be defined as Denver's friend, and that pleases me to no end, because I loved the man and he loved me, and we had a very special friendship.
You know, for 9 years they lived together and they traveled the country, you know, building homeless missions, and you definitely see their handprint, you know. And Ron's such a, like I said, he's such a good one to carry that torch. So now let's just get a bunch more people to go carry that torch.
It begins with one person making a decision to put their hands on something or into something that needs fixing, and recognizing your own ability to have an effect. And it trickles down from there. You empower someone else, and they empower someone else.
I'm Debbie.
What's your name?
It reverberates. And we need that. We need that.
I honestly don't think ultimately that the movie is pushing a message of, you need to go do this. I think it's a much more subtle message and much more powerful because of it. I think that it tells honestly the story of some people who got more out of something than they gave. And I think if you watch that and it happens honestly on screen, I think maybe that message enough will work for people. It'll hopefully inspire in its own way.
Whether we is rich, or whether we is poor, or some in between, we is all homeless. Every last one of us. Just working our way back home. Welcome home, Miss Debbie. Welcome home.
It's rare that you get to make a movie that feels like it could really inspire people on this level, you know? And sadly, I think our world's in a place where we need that kind of inspiration. So it's an honor to get to make a movie that's really about this and about the difference that we can all make and about how we're all just the same, really, at the end of the day.